across Wisconsin from Civic Media. This is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Breitlow.
Well, hey there, Wisconsin. Good morning. It's 6:06 on this Thursday morning, April 11th, 2024. It's another beautiful day to welcome you up north, live from Lake Wissota, from wherever you're listening across the Civic Media Radio Network. And if you're joining us instead by the app or watching us on social media or listening as a podcast, we are thrilled to have you along as well. Always welcome your input at 855-75-CIVIC. You can call or text that number. I got a question for you. Actually, I got a few. Are you aware that there's a statewide tornado drill today? Because there is. It's getting to be that time of the season. So in the early afternoon, you're going to hear the sirens go off, and just know that that is a reminder to everybody to have a plan, to know where you would go, especially if you're not in your usual spot. Do you remember all of your tornado safety rules? And do you want to make sure the kids are prepared for severe weather as it comes up? So it's just a good day when they have these, you know, blank awareness days. In this case, Tornado Awareness Day has a really good purpose to it. We want to keep you all safe. Here's what else is coming up this morning. There is a new federal standard for PFAS, those industrial chemicals that are increasingly being found in our drinking water. And the new federal standard is much stronger than what's already on the books in Wisconsin. It makes it even more imperative that the money approved by the legislature gets put to work on cleanup. And yet, Republicans in the legislature continue to sit on $125 million until industry is given more protection, showing where their priorities are. We're going to have multiple candidates making official announcements this morning that they are running for seats in the state legislature. We also have our Women Win Wisconsin segment now hosted by our friends at Motherhood for Good, and their first guest this week will be Secretary of State Sarah Godlewski. We'll talk to Joe Zepecki. We'll talk to meteorologist Brittany Merlot. We will review last night's episode of Top Chef with Luke Mathers with the theme, Teamwork Makes the Dream Work. If you engage in teamwork, if you don't, you're going home. So we've got a lot to talk about, including a nice forecast with some chances of precipitation in there. But boy, do we have a warm-up coming up ahead of us. Right now, it's 40 degrees here in Chippewa Falls, 29 in Hayward, Park Falls at 32, Wausau 48, Green Bay 47, La Crosse 44, Wisconsin Rapids 41, Oshkosh is at 45 degrees, Madison 43, and in the sleepy little hamlet of Waukesha, it is 45 degrees, where we find one Greg Bach standing by. And what do we got today? A Lake Point Brewery t-shirt, I believe.
Good morning, Lake Mr. Point Bach. Brewery? What are you talking about?
What does that say?
Lakefront.
Lakefront. Really? We're going to, you're an eye chart right now to me, and you're sitting, you know, 200 miles away.
I figure you just would have heard of one of the oldest breweries, actually one of the oldest microbreweries in Wisconsin.
No.
Come on, man. Come on.
I got the Liney's Brewery. I can throw a rock and hit it here almost. So I got that going.
Liney's, with your corporate beer. I'm just kidding. I'm not. Please don't sue me. No, it's a Lakefront Brewery t-shirt. I still work there on occasion, but I used to be an employee there on the regular. It's a nice shirt.
So you worked in the brewery, kind of like Laverne and Shirley at the old Schatz Brewery?
Yeah, actually, like they were part of our tour. I was a tour guide, and I called myself a beer slinger.
A beer slinger. Yep. I like that.
Because okay. I'm not, you know, there are people out there who can really, you know, when it comes like anything, like whether it's wine or cheese or other foods or beer, they'll be like, you can taste the blah, blah, blah,
the fine notes of
the fine notes of this 100-year-old oak barrel on top of my father's my father's World War II sweat. I just like, if I like it, I'm going to tell you I like it.
Tastes good.
Yep. I like it. You might like it. If it's not your jam, I'll get you something else.
Yep. That's where we're at. And again, we're not your beer Sherpa here. We just know when we like something mm-hmm. and when we don't.
Yep.
So that works. That works out yeah. well. Yesterday, I was cleaning out more of the garage to get ready for some drywalling that's going to take place in there today.
Are you doing the drywalling or is someone coming in?
Heck no.
Okay. I don't doubt the prodigious nature of one Pat Kreitlow. Everything he do.
I took everything off all of the walls and piled it in the center of the garage. That was my job yesterday. And I got to thinking, geez, maybe our clean sweep is coming up. You know, it's springtime and various counties have their clean sweep. So I found my little note here from Chippewa County, my little brochure, and it is day after tomorrow. It's this Saturday at the Northern Wisconsin State Fairgrounds. And so it's where I've got to start getting together the old paint cans, the fluorescent bulbs. Let's see, I don't have waste motor oil. I haven't changed my own motor oil since 1986.
Oh, I have waste motor oil. Oh, you could take that to AutoZone or Advanced Auto Parts.
Oh, sure. Yep, antifreeze. I know we get some extra of that because one of our previous vehicles liked to leak antifreeze. That wasn't very healthy. So whatever your county, whatever your clean sweep is for the spring, you might want to look that up. It might be sneaking up on you this weekend.
Thank you for the reminder.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've also got an old TV that's in the garage that I keep meaning to take in at some point and just always, I always seem to miss these clean sweeps. So I'm remembering this time.
Is it a flat screen or an old TV?
No, it's an old,
Gotcha.
Old okay. Tubular, as it were.
Nice, man. Yeah, tubular. All right.
At 6:13, let's jump into some headlines here because I saw a note on the social media feeds, especially from Emily Fannin at CBS 58 in Milwaukee. And it just gives you pause of what we're still having to deal with 3.5 years after the 2020 election. Specifically, I'm talking about a state senator from the Racine-Kenosha area named Van Wongard, who initially, when speaking to Emily Fannin on camera yesterday, was there to take a shot at some fellow right-wingers who had been targeting Assembly Speaker Robin Voss for a recall. The recall is going to fail. The recall organizers are unhappy with Voss because he refused to go along with fellow right-wingers who want to continue to lie about what is obvious to everyone, that Trump lost in 2020. So Emily Fannin is asking him about the Voss recall, the failed recall attempt, and he goes on to take a shot at them. But then he goes on this remarkable tangent where it's clear, though he works so hard not to say it explicitly, that he too is still buying into the big lie. Either he really believes there's some kind of secret evidence, or he doesn't believe it, but he doesn't have the courage to stand up to fellow conservatives and tell them to knock it off. Takes about 90 seconds. Give a listen to Van Wongard and Emily Fannin.
We're now going into 2024 here, so we need to be looking ahead. They're talking about starting again and doing another recall on him. Get over it. This is just ridiculous.
Right, and you know, you just mentioned too, there's still a lot of talk about 2020, and there's a lot of Republicans who want to move on from that. What do you think, though, when you hear the former president, Donald Trump, continue to spew falsehoods about the 2020 election when many are trying to move on?
Is it false?
That he won Wisconsin?
Do you have inside information that I don't have? Because I think that there's a potential that Trump could have won here, but we don't actually know. Because there was some shenanigans that was pulled.
Despite a review, despite an audit, despite a review by Will, you still believe the election was stolen from Trump?
Oh, I didn't say it was stolen. Okay. I said, but what I'm saying is that Trump could have won. I don't think all of the documentation that was brought forward is necessarily all the documentation. I think you need to look at all of the factors and do a total investigation. You can't just look at pick and choose and cherry pick what you want. I'm for moving on. 2020 is behind us.
Just want to get clarity, though. You think he won in 2020?
I said I think he has the ability to make the determination in his mind and in his heart, did I win that or not? So we're going to be the thought police now.
Okay. So again, Emily Fannin says, what do you think when Trump spreads falsehoods about 2020? And he interrupts her to say, is it false? Do you have inside information that I don't have? No. Do you, Senator Wongard? He says there's a potential Trump could have won here, meaning he might have won here if only these shenanigans didn't exist. Which to me means he means the votes of Wisconsin Democratic voters in larger cities, that not enough of them were thrown out. Because that's the only way the math works, is if they were to be successful in getting rid of Democratic votes by raising suspicions around the Democratic vote counting and, you know, ballot filling out procedures. And yet, despite court reviews, despite audits, despite the right-wing legal group Will looking at things and saying there's no there, he's saying all the documentation that's been brought forward is not all of the documentation. What? Again, what do you have that still hasn't been brought up in 3.5 years? He says, you got to look at all the factors. Don't cherry pick. But at the same time, I want to move on. But we need an exhaustive investigation. Hello, Michael Gableman. But we got to move on. And then he closes by saying that given all of that that he just said, given all that he just said, it's okay if Donald Trump wants to believe that he won. If my state senator said anything like that up here, I'd say to his face, you should resign. I mean, look, to look at you on TV, you've got enough on your lapel. You got enough lapel pins and flag pins that you look like you're cosplaying a military officer. But that doesn't make you any more American than anybody else. But I'll tell you what makes you less American is knowingly undermining public confidence in elections because your guy lost. And you don't have the moral fiber to stand up for democracy, acknowledge you lost, not claim some kind of funny business, and move on. Talking like this about 2020 has moved into the category of claiming the moon landings were fake. You can bring it up, but people are going to look at you funny. It might be best to keep that to yourself, unless finally you've got some kind of secret other than just, you can't just yell, Dane County, Milwaukee County, ballot harvesting, or Eric Hovde, you know, spewing nonsense about nursing home residents going to be dead soon. We'll unpack some more of the news coming up in just a bit on this Thursday morning, April 11th, live from Lake Wissota on the Civic Media Radio Network. Talk about dirty water in just a minute. First, a little bit of sports at 6:20. Christian Yelich staying hot early in the season, had a first inning home run, his fifth already on the season, a two-run homer. Wade Miley came off the injured list to pitch four innings of one-hit ball to lift the Milwaukee Brewers to a 7-2 win over the Cincinnati Reds. In a steady rain on Wednesday night, the start of the game was delayed nearly 2 hours. But again, the Brewers showed some real offense in the first two innings and hung on throughout the rest of the game to finish that and to take that third game of the series. And the final game of this four-game matchup is set for midday in Cincinnati. Then tomorrow evening, they will start a three-game series in Baltimore. But as for the matinee in Cincinnati, you can listen across the Civic Media Radio Network. Starting at 11:35 this morning on News from the Center in Richland Center, WRJN in Racine, Kenosha, Oshkosh Air Support, and 98Q Country in Park Falls. For the Bucks, Bobby Portis had 30 points, 9 rebounds, and a career-high 5 steals to help the Milwaukee Bucks withstand the absence of Giannis Antetokounmpo and beat the Orlando Magic 117-99 last night. There was good news on Giannis that it does not appear to be any kind of damage to his Achilles tendon when he fell to the floor a couple of days back. It just appears to be a left calf strain. But having not suffered a calf strain of my own that I can recall, I don't know how long it's going to take him to work that out. Hopefully not too deep into the playoffs, which will be starting before much longer. The Bucks are on the road at Oklahoma City tomorrow night and then Orlando Sunday afternoon. That's going to wrap up the regular season, and then on come the playoffs. But you can catch Friday night's game on locally grown radio out of Wisconsin Rapids and Lake Eyre in Amory. Let's talk about PFAS contamination for a bit here, just because, again, there is a new federal standard, something that we've been waiting for a long time, because the discovery of PFAS, which is a category of like some 5,000 different chemicals, man-made chemicals, for things like waterproofing and, you know, nonstick cookware and firefighting foam. And because these chemicals are built to be strong, they don't fully break down in nature. And so a lot of them are finding their way down through the ground into the water supply. And some of these PFAS are seen to cause problems to human health. It's something we just did not appreciate until fairly recently. So the federal government's been studying it, and the EPA now has a new standard out. And that new standard is for drinking water, or for water overall, 4 parts per trillion. I mean, that's how bad this stuff is that 4 parts per trillion is bad news. Wisconsin has a standard right now, but that standard is 70 parts per trillion of these chemicals. And so it's clear a lot more work has to be done. Well, the federal government yesterday, through the Biden administration, did announce that another $9 billion is going to come to communities to help address PFAS contamination, because they have been associated with metabolic disorders, decreased fertility in women, developmental delays in children, and increased risk of some prostate, kidney, and testicular cancers. This is just bad news. So the Environmental Protection Agency, the EPA, has put out some new rules about these PFAS as well. They've said that water utilities must monitor their water supply for PFAS and be required to notify the public and reduce contamination if levels exceed that new 4 parts per trillion for some of these substances. And by the way, they say the enforceable goal is 4 parts per trillion. But if you want to know what is the non-enforceable health-based goal, it's zero. They don't think there should be any PFAS in water to make sure that there isn't some kind of health hazard. Now, public water systems are going to have 3 years to complete their monitoring, and if samples show that their PFAS still exceed these new standards, the utilities are going to have to purchase and install equipment. And again, the federal government's going to provide money, but so is the state government, or at least they would, if Republicans would stay true to their word and allocate the $125 million that they've already set aside to deal with PFAS. It was put in a bill that passed way back last year, and yet the actual allocation of funds they're sitting on, because they wanted Governor Evers to sign a bill that would make it tougher for the DNR to enforce and force to clean up those who dumped the chemicals. And Republicans are more concerned on protecting, industry. Which seems odd, because you should just want to be able to turn on your tap. I'm going to ask Joe Zepecki about that in a bit as well. And yet we're still talking about these games, these political games. And by the way, this is about drinking water supply, but a whole lot of Wisconsinites don't get their drinking water from a typical municipal drinking water system. They get it from the groundwater. And the Republicans in the legislature have, by and large, put off the whole notion of setting a safety standard for groundwater. There's been a couple of attempts to get that through the legislature. Republicans have blocked it each time. And it's left residents with contamination in their private wells with questions about, how would they access the resources and the financial help that would give them the assurance that their drinking water would be clean. Let me open up the news lens just a little bit here and talk a bit about the Arizona abortion ban that their state Supreme Court has upheld, a law that dates back to 1864. Half a century before Arizona became a state, long before women had the right to vote. And I bring it up not to go through the particulars of that law. We'll talk later about how this is going to turn Arizona into such a hotbed of political activity. But people have been asking, how did these abortion laws come up way back when? And I wanted to share a little something I found from the New York Times. And believe it or not, for as much as we have doctors talking about the need to protect abortion care, it was doctors back then who were not happy with midwives and other practitioners that kind of got things rolling. The report says that after the American Medical Association formed in 1847, its members, who at the time were all male and all white, sought to curtail medical activities by midwives and other non-doctors, most of whom were women. Pregnancy termination methods, which have been around since the beginning, were often provided by people in these vocations, and historians say that's one reason why the AMA had a desire to ban abortion, is because they wanted to provide all of the care, and you can imagine how all these white males felt about the care for women with problem pregnancies or pregnancies that were unplanned or undesired. So there is some history about these laws, the Arizona one written in a way that it's still enforceable compared to the Wisconsin 1849 law, which has been interpreted as being about infanticide rather than abortion. Let's talk more about the news with Joe Zepecki coming up in just a bit on Up North News Radio, live from Lake Wasota. News. 6:34 now on this Thursday morning. As always, Joe Zepecki joins us. Joe, good morning.
Hello.
Normally, I give a longer intro. I say, oh, there's this political story, and there's this story, and there's this story. Nope, we're going sports first, just because we're still absorbing the news that the Green Bay Packers are going to open the season in Brazil against the Philadelphia Eagles. But here's the twist. On a Friday night, what do you think of that, Joe?
Insanity. I am so angry about this, that they would put in that time of year when Friday nights should be about high school football is insane. It is a terrible decision by the NFL. I can't believe the Packers went along with it to the extent they had any say in it. I understand starting the NFL season on a Thursday night in prime time. Okay, that's like JV games, junior varsity. But to put an NFL game for the Green Bay Packers on Friday night in the middle of the first home games across the state of Wisconsin after school is in session. You know, the season starts in August, but that first Friday night when school is back in session and everybody wants to go out and support their local team, this is infuriating. I would much rather they say, okay, if we're going to compete with something, let's compete with college football on Saturday night. And then it's at least two money-making endeavors or enterprises against one another. But to pull any focus from kids on Friday night playing high school football, just a real miss from my point of view.
Moving on to news of the week, I guess this is predictable in terms of Governor Evers calling the Joint Finance Committee in, because they're still, what's the word I'm looking for?
Surplus.
They just disagree on what to do with the $125 million in PFAS money. Republicans seem, hell-bent on protecting polluters while denigrating the DNR. I don't see a resolution forward here, Joe.
I don't either. And the feds complicated matters yesterday with a new standard established by the EPA that is in conflict with the state of Wisconsin standard, which has been deemed unenforceable by the courts. I mean, this is just an absolute mess, and it is crying out for somebody to step up and say, we can all agree that anybody in the state of Wisconsin who turns on their tap ought to be able to trust the water that comes out. It's not going to make you or your kids sick, period. here's what we're going to do about it. And the notion that through the democratic process, we agreed, you know, Republicans agreed to $125 million for remediation and for, you know, improvement in this area, and are now just saying, like, actually, on second thought, no thanks. It's pretty frustrating. It seems like another pretty blatant abuse of power. There are other mechanisms available to them if they want to, you know, redo this the next time. Like, here's the upshot of this is, this is going to cost the state of Wisconsin more than $125 million. And I'm totally fine with, by the way, enforcing accountability and holding the polluters to account and getting some of that $125 million or whatever it ends up being back from the companies that did this. But to say, okay, this is in the budget, it's approved, go ahead, and then to go, wait, just kidding, it is so out of line with the normal course of business, it's pretty hard to wrap your head around.
Like you said, anybody should be able to turn on their tap and get water that is not a danger to them. And I just don't see where Republicans make any headway in saying, well, no, we're just going to leave the water dirty until you protect industry the way that we want to. And again, if we still had the gerrymandered maps, we'd probably leave it at that, say, yep, they're probably going to get away with it. Now you just look at these districts, and again, nobody's saying that control is going to flip, but you're going to have a more competitive set of races that could lead to a legislature that, I don't know, actually wants to get things done next
year.
That'd
be nice. That'd be nice. I'm reading a book, a new-ish book, White Rural Rage. The title is pretty provocative. The authors cop to that would not have been their title choice. The publisher thought that would sell more books. They think it's more about white rural resentment. And one of the arguments that they make in the book is that one of the most insidious effects of gerrymandering is it leads to such worse outcomes for rural communities, because Democrats can't win in those districts, so they don't try. Republicans can take those parts of the state for granted, so they don't actually pursue policy solutions to the actual very real challenges facing rural communities. And things just get harder and harder for rural communities. And so I am optimistic anew while reading this book that the new maps will lead to not just a fairer shot for the red team or the blue team, but to a real shot at better outcomes for communities that have been left behind by so much of our politics.
Let's turn then to another area where Republicans have blocked progress, and that is on workforce development. And again, Governor Evers has put forth on multiple occasions a workforce development plan. And what we got instead from the legislature was something that the governor vetoed a couple of days back. And I like that he publicly did it in front of a gathering of union machinists, mm-hmm. is to say, here's what we're not doing. We're not rolling back protections in child labor laws. That's where we're at these days.
Yeah. You know me. I like to try and see where the other side is coming from. And it just sometimes it is increasingly difficult to put yourself in their shoes. They are stomping their feet and hopping mad about a worker shortage. And they don't want to do anything about immigration. Right? Republicans had a chance to get a really good deal by their own admission on immigration, to do something about the border, to make sure, you know, that was under control. And Trump blew it up. And we know that a lot of the growth in our workforce comes from immigrant labor. So they don't want to pursue that policy. They would rather, you know, take money out of public education, preparing kids for the workforce. And then they go, oh, well, if we're not going to fund education, if we're not going to, you know, streamline immigration and come up with a better process that allows, you know, immigrants to come here and do jobs, I got it. Let's make little Timmy and Tommy at 14 years old go do dangerous jobs over the summer. It just, like, having a summer job, I think, is a really important part of growing from young adulthood to adulthood. I'm not suggesting that young people shouldn't have summer jobs, but to roll back the protections And that, you know, as the governor explained in his veto message, I just don't get it. And I got to give a hat tip to Deb Andraca, who had the best line. The solution to the worker shortage is not shorter workers. And she's very right. Although we, of course, have a 15-year-old in this house who's anything but short, over 6 feet tall. They're not all short.
No, but it works. It definitely works. Let's talk about the campaign and how you talk about a particular topic. The Progressive Group Opportunity Wisconsin has billboards up this week targeting Congressman Derek Van Orden and Brian Stile, basically for where their priorities are when it comes to taxes, and specifically if what the Republicans did in 2017 should be extended. Former President Trump is already promising to extend tax breaks for the very wealthy that were scheduled to expire next year, I believe. But if they just campaign alone and saying, we're going to cut your taxes the way we cut your taxes in 2017, how do progressives counter that?
Well, it's a question of priorities, right? And who these folks are working for. We know Donald Trump is in it for himself. So the reason he wants to give, you know, huge tax breaks and was caught on a secret video telling these rich, you know, titans of industry, by the way, those industries being things like payday loans and really seedy, nasty stuff, that he's going to cut their taxes, is because he thinks he'll get a tax cut too. And that's what Donald Trump is about. He's about himself. And when you look at the rest of the Republican conference, you know, I think at the end of the day, you just got to say, these are the wrong priorities and they don't match our district, right? If you live in Southeast Wisconsin, 99% of folks are not making $1 million or more a year. If you live in Western Wisconsin, you're not making millions and millions of dollars a year. You know, the choice to extend these tax cuts is a choice to further income inequality. We know that those at the very, very top have been doing really, really well. We know that the pandemic exacerbated some of that income inequality. And what we need are representatives who understand the communities they represent and are fighting for them. The alternative is the Joe Biden plan, which is that nobody who makes less than $400,000 a year would see their taxes go up one penny. But you would see, you know, a billionaire's tax, you would see corporate tax rates return to the rates that they were during some of the best economic times in this country's history. And that is the choice. So if you want tax cuts for the uber wealthy and big corporations, then Donald Trump, Derek Van Orden, Brian Stile, those are your guys. If you believe that the tax code is not as fair as it should be and you know, believe that there's a better way forward, Joe Biden, Tammy Baldwin, Democrats up and down the ballot. That's the choice.
All right, let's go to a different race where, again, it's how you talk about an issue or how you have just any consistent message. And, of course, we're talking about Eric Hovde in the U.S. Senate race, who over the past week or so has said, you know, nursing home voters will be dead soon, so why bother? He repeated so many of Donald Trump's big lie talking points about the 2020 election. He's really emphasizing the border in his TV ads. And I would remind people, we are not anywhere near the southern U.S. border. But of course, he thinks that it's going to poll well. It just leads me to say, does Eric Hovde have a consistent message that I'm just missing at this point? Or is he still kind of throwing everything at the wall?
This campaign and this candidate are a total mess. And I wanted better of Eric Hovde, not because there's any chance I'm going to vote for him, but because there's a chance that he could win. Wisconsin is a 50-50 state. So I want Tammy Baldwin to go back. But I wake up every day knowing there's a real possibility that she won't. And therefore, I want a rational, reasonable, sane Republican who knows what they're doing. Eric Hovde every day is like dumber than the one before. The notion, like, he made a choice to stand on a stage with Donald Trump and to accept an endorsement from someone under 91 felony criminal indictments who has been found guilty by a jury of his peers of sexual assault, whose businesses were so crooked and corrupt that he's on the hook for almost $500 million in fines. Eric Hovde didn't have to stand on that stage with Donald Trump, and he did. That's a choice. Then the next day, amidst, you know, between the second and third time within the last week that Donald Trump is once again falsely claiming he won Wisconsin, it's this mishmash of word salad of Eric Hovde going, well, I'm just really focused on looking forward. I'm just really, you know, clearly there were questions. Clearly, seniors in nursing homes are so close to death. Why would they even be able to cast a ballot? What the hell is he talking about? Like, Trump and look, lost.
To be fair, nobody, he never said they shouldn't vote, but he certainly implied through what he said that, you know, he basically tried to say that there's some kind of hanky panky without any proof, which makes him no better than Donald Trump.
He said, if you're in a nursing home, you only have 5 or 6 months left to live, and there's no, and at no point should you be voting. That's maybe not exactly word for word, but here's the challenge. It's that the tell is that's nonsense. He's just trying to use weasel words to get on to the next thing. And he knows that the right ultra MAGA wing of the Republican Party has so thoroughly had their brains cooked by Donald Trump that he has to throw them a sop, right? Like, Eric Hovde has owns nursing homes as part of his hundreds of millions of dollars worth of holding. Presumably he has met patients and understands they ought to be able to vote, but he's not any different from any other Republican in that he is choosing to be held captive to what Donald Trump has done and the rot within the Republican Party as a result. Eric Hovde didn't have to make that choice. He has. Color me really, really disappointed.
Joe Zepecki, good to talk to you. Hope you enjoyed the start to the weekend. Talk to you later.
Bye-bye.
We'll have more after this. You're up north.
I'm singing in the rain, just singing in the rain. What a glorious feel, and I'm happy again.
How do you not feel better just listening to
that? I'm laughing at
you. You know, I know, and yeah, you're right. It's my wife, one of my wife's favorite movies ever.
The sun's in my heart, and I'm ready for love.
Let's as a kid, you know, we watch what I would now consider a lot of old movies. Yeah. And Singing in the Rain was one I'd seen repeatedly. And Gene Kelly, I mean, just come on. Look at that dancing. Everybody gives Fred Astaire his due. But, you know, Gene Kelly, Donald O'Connor, who was in this movie as well.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, Danny Kaye and White Christmas, all doing something our generation of men, but we don't do that. There's no tap dancing.
Yeah. And there was no calling Gene Kelly like, oh, he dances. No, that was a manly man. And he controlled those sets, and he wrote the movies and directed. And we just watched another one, the one with him and Frank Sinatra.
On the Town?
What was that?
Is it On the Town where they're all sailors?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay, that was it. Yeah, I thought it was something else. But yeah, yeah. Watching Frank Sinatra try to... He keeps up with Gene Kelly, but Gene Kelly is just dancing with all the fun on his face, where Frank Sinatra's like, don't mess this up. Don't mess this up.
Totally understandable. Hope it motivates some of you. Look up an old movie. Yeah. Watch an old movie over the weekend here. On this day, and by the way, that movie was released this day in 1952. On this day in 1961, a relatively new young fella from Minnesota played for the first time in Greenwich Village, opening for John Lee Hooker. His name was Bob Dylan, Bob Zimmerman. Was it Bob Zimmerman? Was that his
name? Yeah, his name is Robert Zimmerman.
Robert Zimmerman. But changed it to Bob Dylan, and he performed this brand new song for the crowd.
How many roads must a man walk down before you call him a man?
So again, that was this day in 1961 when he first opened up in Greenwich Village.
Nice. Before she sleeps. This is Bob Dylan I like. I like this Bob Dylan.
Yeah. You said you have a little trivial nugget about this song?
Yes, it was said that Sam Cook heard this song, and he was so bothered that he didn't write this song, that he went on to write A Change Is Gonna Come Around.
Oh.
He felt this song was so powerful. It was like, no, I should have wrote this song.
Wow.
And I mean, I just, goosebumps. I love Sam Cooke. But yes, every time I hear this song, I think of him.
That was today in 1961. This day in 1963, the Kingsmen recorded Louie Louie, which are really the only lyrics to the song that you know. Everything else is gibberish. Speaking of Frank Sinatra, oh. on this day in 1966, Old Blue Eyes recorded Strangers in the Night, which is noteworthy only because there's an expression when anybody does an impression of him.
Yes.
And I guess he simply improvised it here at the end of the song. Give a listen to the end.
Turned out so right for strangers in the night.
All right, Frank, you got to do something. Just fill the time.
Doo-dee-doo-be-doo. Doo-doo-doo-dee-da-da-da-da-da.
Doo-be-doo-be-doo.
The album cover that's on this track, the background is blue, and his eyes are the same color, which just makes him look like a robot.
Well, yeah. Some would say it accentuates the blue eyes, but no, we're gonna go with the robot here. I like that. Tony Up and Hayward talks about Blown in the Wind and says he loves the song and that his dad's name is Bob Zimmerman, too.
Your dad is Bob Dylan?
Oh, my goodness. How did Tony not tell us this previously? Goodness. On this day in 1970, the Beatles spent the first of 2 weeks at the top of the charts with Let It Be. It's worth noting, if you pay attention to the history segment, that this was only, it hit number one only a day after Paul McCartney said, we're done as a group.
When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary.
This album was recorded before Abbey Road.
Words of
yes.
Wisdom,
yep.
Let it be.
Also on this same day, 1970, Apollo 13 launched. Didn't go as well as it could have. Didn't go as badly as it could have. There's only one birthday of note today. A singer, Joss Stone, is 37 today.
You have me, you lost me, you wasted, you caught me. I don't want you here messing with my mind.
She was born this day in 1987. And then on this day in 1988, Cher won the Academy Award for Best Actress for the romantic comedy Moonstruck, which is noteworthy mostly for the way that she pulls off this line when the character says that he's in love with her.
I'm in love with you.
Snap out of it!
If only it were that easy. Like, okay, I'm not in love with you anymore. Although, being pummeled across the face a couple of times, that might do it.
And that's Nicolas Cage saying that, and you know he said to her, slap me for real.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I looked back a couple times. I'm like, yeah, there was no faking that.
I can feel that.
So if you're him, you think, please get this right on the first take. Now, yesterday was National Hug Your Dog Day, if I recall correctly. Today is just National Pet Day.
Oh.
So any pet that you might have, you know, doesn't say to hug them, but go ahead. Give him a little squeeze.
I'm gonna go.
Unless it's a parakeet, then don't squeeze too much.
Ooh, why?
Yikes. There is a place here that does kind of the, every spring kind of does the baby animals, mm-hmm. you know, on the farm thing, little lambs and things like that.
Yeah.
Sherry always talks about how bad she feels for the little baby chicks. Because those little kids come up and they grab them and they're holding them just a little too hard. And she thinks that there's probably a higher mortality rate than we want to acknowledge with the baby chicks.
Those kids going all Lenny on those little animals, are they? They're just mm-hmm. squeezing them.
Yep. I will hold him and pet him and squeeze him and hold him. This is National Barbershop Quartet Day. I did not bring two other people to join me and Greg. We will not be singing that today. It's Clean Up Your Pantry Day.
Oh, God.
I actually kind of did that yesterday. I was like, there was like a third of a box of rigatoni. And I'm like, when did I make rigatoni?
Everyone's got at least one box of pasta in their house.
Where they go, I don't remember using this the first time. So and I had a little leftover spaghetti sauce from a few days ago. So I'm like, all right, I'm having rigatoni for dinner. It was not satisfying, but it cleaned out the pantry.
Yep.
This is National Cheese Fondue Day. This is Parkinson's Awareness Day. This is National 8-Track Tape Day.
Nice.
Which does not deserve a day because it was such a lesser technology. And I'm really glad we've moved on. And it's National Poutine Day. And all I'll ever say about poutine is everybody in Wisconsin, we should be embarrassed. How did we let Canada invent poutine? That sounds so classically Wisconsin.
I know.
Cheese curds, French fries, gravy. It's the best. Good job, Canada. We are embarrassed.
Good job, eh?
Hey, Motherhood for Good has our Women Win Wisconsin segment and a couple of assembly candidates coming up next. You're up north.